Before our family moved here to League City, I had worked in Corsicana, where I'd spent 3 years with a wonderful congregation. But in the middle of that work, about 2 years into that work, it had become a job. I had lost my passion for service. I'd just begun to be in a really bad place personally. And so as I was in the middle of the week following a Sunday in which it had become obvious to not only me, but some others as well, that that was the case, that something wasn't right, I got a knock on my door. And one of our elders in Corsicana walks in and sits down to talk to me. And that conversation and him taking that opportunity changed many things and had a powerful impact in my life. I want to tell you a little bit more about that story, and I want to suggest to you in just a moment from 1 Peter chapter 5 that God is demanding, encouraging, even demanding, I believe, for all of us to have a similar experience. But I did, before we get into that, I wanted to let you know that this is not a bad dream. You may think it's bad, but it's not a dream. You're in the right place. You didn't click off on the wrong video. We did not plan for me to show up over and over again in this experience. But Tyler, who, if you're visiting with us, is our preacher, he is in a more important place today. He is with his wife, Kim. They are in LaGrange, Texas. As many of you know, because you've been praying for Kim's father, Jack Sedwick. Jack passed away Friday. And so because he is having an opportunity to be there, they're mourning his passing, celebrating that victory, but just spending that time together, we're grateful that they have that opportunity. I asked Tyler for just a little bit of information about Jack, and he shared with me, he said, Jack was an elder. He was an elder for many years in Dripping Springs and in LaGrange, where they are now. He was a native Texan. He had 3 daughters, 11 grandchildren, and 4, Tyler says, great-grandchildren. Those 4 great-grandchildren are, of course, are Tyler and Kim's grandchildren. But he went on to say he was a 3-time Travis County powerlifting champion, and he once saved an entire village in the Amazon basin from a horde of ferocious fire ants using only a glass of water and a hoe. He also said, I might have made up that last stuff. But in Tyler fashion, he shared that information. But another reason I'm glad that he is there with them at this time and they're able to spend that time together. I know you're glad for them to have that time. But I'm also honored to get to spend this time with you to preach the gospel of Jesus and to think about what he's trying to communicate to us in this message. And as I began to study and put together those thoughts, I thought about Kim's father, Jack, his service as an elder. And it reminded me of this verse in 1 Timothy chapter 5, where Paul wrote to Timothy, said, hey, let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor. Hey, there is a great respect and there is an honor and that should be bestowed upon these individuals. And so as I thought about that idea, one of my favorite texts and great places to look, 1 Peter chapter 5 describes so well what it means to be an elder, or really how important that office is in the church and for each of us. And so I've always been blown away at how important God reveals that elders are. And then I was truly in awe as we look at this text to see and to think about how beautiful, as we sang a moment ago, how beautiful it is in terms of what God did in providing the chief shepherd for all of us and the way that all of these relationships fit together. It is a powerful text. We will not have time to be able to dig in and look at everything, but I want to share just briefly, three things that we need to be, that I uncovered that I want to share with you. Three things, one that we need to be mindful of, the second thing, something that we ought to meditate on, and finally, something that will motivate us to have a similar experience in which I had, and that really had a powerful impact on my life, and I'm sure many have had, but that ought to exist and cause us to realize from 1 Peter chapter 5, we need a shepherd, and you have a shepherd for your soul. Let's begin as we look at this text in 1 Peter chapter 5. Would you read with me? 1 Peter 5, beginning in verse 1, I exhort the elders among you, as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that's going to be revealed. Shepherd the flock of God that's among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you, not in a shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but be examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Listen, in honor of Jack, the six great men that we serve with, I think that this is a wonderful study. And first of all, we need to be mindful of just a few things, in my opinion. Again, can't see everything, and I hope you'll spend some time in this text to really uncover some wonderful things. But notice first the terms that describe elders. You see, as you read through here, different terms. He starts off with first, elders, right? I exhort you, elders. I myself am an elder. There's something specific about this idea. There's a title. As a partaker of the glory that's going to be revealed. Notice he says, shepherd the flock of God. Shepherd, it's a word that is used and interchanged for us as it's come into English for an idea of what this office is. And you may be familiar with our more current word and use of that word shepherd, which is pastor. Pastor and shepherd come from this same word. And when you look at what that word was and developing in the Latin, it became to talk about literally to lead to pasture, to feed, and to be able to help, set to grazing and feed them. And we'll talk more about that in just a moment. But there is another word you find in that helps us and relates us to this idea that elders have divine authority. We need to be mindful of that. In Acts 20, in verse 28, Paul is speaking to the elders at Ephesus, this great church in Ephesus, and he tells the Ephesian elders, listen, the Holy Spirit, right, shepherd, oversee, the Holy Spirit has made you an overseer of that flock. And I encourage you to go look at that really great section of scripture which discusses the elder's role in there and Paul's sort of concern from them. But he uses another word that we get our word bishop from, but overseer. All of these words are talking about this idea that we see in 1 Peter chapter 5. But we know there's several terms we need to be mindful as we think about that: pastor, shepherd, elder, overseer, bishop, these different terms, but they have divine authority. Notice he says in this text, shepherd the flock of God that's among you exercising oversight. I've given you this oversight, God says. There's a way they have that oversight. We'll see in a moment. But here, let's go back to that word, the purpose of a shepherd. Right? This is one of those words. Again, it's the same word. It's interchangeable with this idea of pastor. Right? Our pastors are individuals who do what? Well, one of the places that I think can really give us insight into what God had planned for that work and what they were supposed to be doing and really how it can benefit all of us can be seen in John chapter 21 and verse 17. There's much more to be seen and looked at in this text as well, but perhaps some of you can recall that this is the time when Peter is having to look at Jesus face to face after he has betrayed him. And he's been asked once, he's been asked twice, and then the third time, Jesus looks at him and says, Simon, which is Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Yes, yes, I love you. Well, what does he ask of him? If you love me, and he's confirmed that he loves him, and he wants to know for sure that he loves Jesus, the chief shepherd. So then he says, feed my sheep. That is one of the main purposes of a pastor or a shepherd, an elder, to feed the sheep. We need to be mindful of this idea, these terms that describe them and make this up, and it helps us get an understanding of their role and who gave them that role. And hey, they have an obligation that God has given them to feed the sheep. As I am a sheep, yes, the Lord is my shepherd. But here, as Jesus told Peter, and Peter is telling elders, you'll notice he's talking, says, I exhort the elders among you. He's narrowing in. He's talking to them right now, especially in these first four verses. He changes in verse 5. We'll see that in a moment. But the purpose of a shepherd, right? Feed the sheep. We need to, after a mindful of that, really meditate on the relationship between shepherds and sheep. I think this plan that God has is really something remarkable. It's something special. But why did Peter, as he begins to tell these shepherds, did he bring up something that, are you just a downer, Peter? Or you just somebody that's always negative, you know, and somebody like that. No matter what you say, it's always got to have this negative feel or downer. You just aren't happy. You're always bringing, was that Peter's attitude? I don't think so. But notice how he starts this section. Hey, I'm an elder. Listen, you're an elder. I'm an elder. But realize, he says, I'm also a witness of the sufferings of Christ. Couldn't you just left that out? We know in the greater context, he couldn't have left that out. And First Peter's talking about how to suffer as a Christian, why that is necessary. But in this context, I couldn't help but think of the difficulty that shepherds have, that our elders have as they walk through and maybe experience suffering at a different, they experience some of the same sufferings, but they also experience your suffering. And they ought to experience my suffering and your suffering in a greater way. Called to oversee and to be able to nourish the souls and feed the souls of individuals who are what? Who are hurting, who are needing help. Have you ever tried to feed somebody? This whole quarantine business has made that a little bit more difficult for a lot of families. We're one of those families, not in terms of having enough food in that time, but like, how do we, what are the rules? Like, the kitchen's open all the time now, and not literally, but it's like, hey, there's access. And so, we have to set some new guidelines, and we just can't eat all day, but hey, I want to just eat. What do you do whenever you're home all day? And so, have you ever tried to feed someone, parents? I have three boys. We have three boys. And so, one of our boys is an incredible eater. He always has been. And so, he will eat anything you put in front of him. And actually, Mom, one of the areas she's given free rein to in our kitchen is the produce section. You can eat fruits and vegetables all day long if you want to, and he does. And so he's constantly eating healthy, anything he'll eat. We have another son who he's sort of in between the other two. Isn't it interesting how they're all different? And he mostly eats really well, but he'll at least taste it. He doesn't like everything, doesn't eat quite as well as the other, but he at least has a pretty good attitude and will try things and is a better. Well, we have one that I don't know how he's alive. It's quite incredible. I have anxiety over the, like, how are you healthy? Like, are you healthy? You can't be healthy. You don't eat anything. And why don't you eat? And he's always got to turn his nose up and he's disgusted at, oh, we're eating that again. And like, can't you be grateful? And I wonder, as I thought about my three boys and where you might fall in when it comes to how you eat. How do you feed your soul, especially when it revolves around this relationship between shepherds and sheep. How do we address this idea? What is the way that we should interact? And there is a greater insight here when you begin to see 5 through 7. 5 through 7 in 1 Peter chapter 5. I do not, unfortunately, have that for you, but hopefully you have your Bibles. You can see I'll read this for you. Likewise, you who are younger, hey, be subject to the elders. Clothe yourselves, all of you. Well, what are we supposed to wear? Humility toward one another. For God opposes the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. And so, humble yourselves, therefore, to all of you under the mighty hand of God, so at the proper time He'll exalt you. Cast your anxieties on Him because He cares for you. And so, here in this relationship, you see back, if you look back, well, we often want to point out, hey, elders, you have this responsibility. Not for shameful gain. You're supposed to be there for me, and we put these expectations on them, and rightly so, right? Don't be domineering over those in your charge. Be lead by example. And they have those commands, and they have that obligation. And yet there's also an obligation for us. And there's this mutually beneficial idea, humility, as we have interact with one another and we meditate on this idea of feeding. Where do you fall? Do you always have something negative? Are you helping to make it a delight to sit around the table? Oh, I love it when the third one likes what is good. What we're having for dinner, it like makes everything like, yes, he's grateful, right? And he doesn't mean it any hard way. And I think that ultimately we don't mean it in any negative way. We're looking out for ourselves, right? We know what we like to eat and what we don't like to eat. But sometimes you've got to eat some vegetables. Sometimes you have to have a hard pill to swallow when the chief shepherd looked Peter face to face, right? There are some times in which we need some help. And that's why I hope you're motivated. The chief shepherd will motivate you, and we think about why, and we bring this together, and let this lesson be yours as we begin to close. Listen, he goes on to say, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, he's prowling around like a roaring lion. He's seeking someone to devour. That's why shepherds are so important. Listen, we get distracted, and we're working, and we have all these things going on in our lives, and Satan is using those. He's trying to attack us, and he's using this time in many ways to do that, perhaps. And he's using this time in many ways, perhaps, because of the oversight and the help of our elders and the way they're organizing things to feed your soul. And maybe this is one of those ways. But we could talk about so many things, but the devil is roaring around. He says in verse 9, resist him, stand firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering, they're experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. Yes, it's not always easy. And actually, it's never easy. And that's why we should be motivated to think about the chief shepherd and the shepherds he's placed here. After you've suffered a little while, notice this, the God of all grace, who's called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will what? He'll restore. He will confirm, strengthen, and establish you. It's incredible to think about how God used Peter for this message. You remember the verse we looked at a moment ago? I took a little bit of that verse out, and now I've put it back in. Here was Peter's response, and even more than what he said, we get a little insight into how he was feeling. You remember as he's facing Jesus, I've come face to face with the individual I lied to and I betrayed, the Savior of my soul, my chief shepherd, Simon, son of John. He said the third time, do you love me? Notice Peter's response. He was grieved. He was vexed. He was hurting deep inside because he said to him the third time, do you love me? He said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know I love you. Oh, to come to a place and to have somebody look you face to face and to be able to help you and help you realize and understand that you really do love Jesus. And that from now on, I'm going to be motivated to work and live in a certain way. I told you about the time I was sitting in my office in Corsicana, and that good man knocked on the door and came in, and the middle of a really depressing moment and a depressing time and just a difficult period and wondering and doubts, and it began to build me up. Say, we appreciate you. Highlighted some of the things that he appreciated and ways that I was serving well, and it was good to hear. I didn't expect it because I didn't feel it. But then he also added, like Jesus did in Revelation to the seven churches of Asia, I have something against you. Here are some of the ways, Cory, in which I think maybe you're missing the mark. And he didn't use those exact words, but he began not only to highlight that, but here's some things we can do to fix it. And I want to help you. And ultimately, what that helped me do is to realize my purpose. I'm serving the chief shepherd, that I could have a moment like Peter where you realize, hey, I love the Lord, and this is why I'm doing that. Have you had an experience like that? Where you just needed somebody, and as God put this plan together, and sometimes we don't eat and we don't graze on what we should be grazing on, and we need help, and God organized it in a way that some mature individuals, men like Jack Sedgwick, who loved Jesus, who raised incredible family, has this legacy of Christian, this family that love him, and it's those types of people that can come and sit down with you. They're good wives, and encourage us and remind us about what is important, to motivate us to walk with Jesus and remember what is most important. That blows out of the water the idea that I can do church by myself, that I don't need to be a part of the family of God. God has ordained. The Holy Spirit has made these men overseers for this very purpose, that we can have Peter moments, that can have moments like I had. And he demands that we have moments. What have you done to connect with our elders to make it a delight for them to serve you? Maybe you feel they've done something wrong, and what a great opportunity to speak to them and talk to them, or to motivate them and encourage them, because I've had the privilege now after a couple of years to sit around the table with these six good men and to pray with them and to shed tears with them, and to realize that while they are men and may not always do and say the right things, they love you, they love this body. If you've never come to know your chief shepherd, they would love nothing more than for that to take place. And if you would like to learn more about what it means to become a Christian and give him your life, we'd love to study that with you and encourage you to do that. For our members and others that already know him as your chief shepherd, what can you do to encourage them, to be encouraged yourself, to meditate on the beautiful plan that God has put in place to build up our souls, to encourage us, to provide a rich heritage for us and our families and our communities? What a privilege we have to study God's Word. If I could study with you, if I can encourage you some way, I know of many others. We're here for you, even though we are separated. We can't meet together in person. We are certainly together in spirit, but we want to connect with you in the messages. Could you let us know how you're doing? Can we get to know you better? We would just love to have that opportunity. But more than anything, I hope that God has blessed you, that you have a great week.